It's a pleasure for me here today to have Professor Ngoba Chau from the University of Chicago. I'm joined here by Professor Claudio Arezzo, who is the head of the mathematics section at ICTP. Professor Chau, he's a professor at University of Chicago and a Fields Medalist, and also a member of ICTP Scientific Council. So it's a pleasure for me to welcome you here. Let me start with this question regarding your Fields Medal in 2010. And as I recall, it was awarded in India, in Chennai, right? This
Allahabad,
for proving what is known as the fundamental lemma, which is a critical statement by Langlands at the end of the 70s, which had resisted any attempts to prove it for like 30 years. So I know that it's not easy to translate this to a lay person, but maybe to, let's say, an uncultured physicist, if you had to explain this, can you explain the importance of this result, or the broadly, what is the Langlands program and how does it relate to the rest of mathematics?
Hello, Atish. Hello, Claudio. It's always a pleasure to me to come back to the ICTP. It's such a wonderful place for doing science and to enjoy life in general. And so let say a couple of words about this fundamental lemma. I think it it emerged as kind of some annoyance more than any kind of serious problem at the beginning at first. So in the, you know, by the end of the 60s, beginning of the 70s, kind of Langlands came up with kind of pretty very both deep and broad vision about number theory, representation theory, and all this stuff. And we all coming back together in both very simple and rather simple and penetrating way of explaining many things on the number theory. So, and also he kind of envisioned some kind of role toward how people can work to solve to his program, and that is the choice formula. The choice formula is, you know, this. On one side, what you really want to understand is the spectrum, automorphic spectrum, how operators act on this automorphic representation, that a representation of Lie group that have arithmetic significance, right? And the other side, and you know, when you the trail of the spectrum can be written as, you know, more kind of oblongate, some more geometric object, right? That appears in Riemannian geometry with paper of Sandberg and so on and so on. But then Langlands very soon realized that there's some little annoyance when you do this, because there's some Galois theoretic problem. There's some discrepancy between conjugacy class, say over real numbers and over complex numbers. You see on the look at rotation of angle theta and angle minus theta, and they look very similar, but you cannot conjugate them inside S on 2 of R, right? And that is kind of the beginning of the problem with fundamental lemma, right? And this is then Langlands go up, then it was not just an annoyance, but there's some kind of very interesting trace identities that kind of go into this package, right? And then you look at you know, when you look at SN2R, there are two discrete series of SN2R, right? Which look similar. That it comes from the same repeated GN2R, when you actually kind of break into two parts. And when you make a difference of the characters, and it becomes some character of the torus, of the compact torus. And that is one of the main examples of this kind of endoscopic phenomenon. So this kind of first of all, the representation SM2R do not come alone, but they come into packet. They are kind of two representation packet, right? Inside a packet, the difference of characters somewhere come from a smaller group, from these compact groups. And that, you know, Langlands at this period, he can immediately foresee a larger pictures, not for SM2, but for every group, and not only for real numbers, but for periodic spin and so on. And he's kind of some period where Langlands has kind of extraordinary length of vision. It's just one phenomenon you can just extrapolate on over the mathematics, right? And then he immediately saw the arithmetic of Shimura varieties and so on. So then he came up with look a bit technical, right? But it's very fundamental. You understand choice formula, you understand Komol Shimura varieties, that, you know, to realize his way to his Langlands program using trace formula, using Komol Shimura varieties. Well, at the beginning, he called it the lemma, because he's fundamental lemma, because it's important. It's kind of a very critical piece in his program. But it's just a lemma, because at the beginning, he can do it by mere computation. He just calculate whatever integral he encounter with. But it was, and people keep trying this for many, many years. But of course, I mean, when the group become bigger, there's no way you can't keep this integral anymore. And people, like, when I start doing mathematics, then people already kind of understood that you need to have another way to do it, with not just by calculation, because calculation, you know, you calculate, but you need to have a language to express your reason, but then you're kind of missing even the, you don't have expected formula anymore, right? So that is, the fundamental lemma. You know.
But can you maybe elaborate a bit about the, so number theoretic, in this SL2R example, uh-huh. So you talked about representation. Yeah. So can you explain for the audience, let's say, the relation to number theory in this example, or is there some...
The number theory come up, it can be the same for periodic numbers. The SM2 of QP is very similar to SM2 of R. Just a bit more complicated, right? So again, you know, representation of SM2 of QP come into packet, a packet of two. You know, when a recipe representation from GN2 of QP, you get a packet of two, and then the difference is coming from the torus. But there are, for SM2 of R, you have two torus. You have the split torus, diagonal matrix, and the compact torus come from the complex numbers. But QP have four different extensions. There's the split extension, there's unramified extension, there's two ramified extensions. A bit more complicated. And also that is one of the question, locally question, but also the kind of global question that is now when you have. It's a representation that is kind of packet. But on matrices, you know, there's kind of metrics that become conjugate in GN2 or in the same group, but when you go to extend scalar to the algebraic closed field, like complex numbers, right? So this problem exists for every single P, right? And so you can ask yourself a question that what happens if, you start with some conjugacy class in SL2 of Q, to rational number, but you're really doing arithmetic now. And at every single place, you can just switch from one conjugacy to his twin brother, so to speak. And by the end, does it come from conjugacy class from Q? So that's quite a typical arithmetic question, right? And this is really used to understand choice formula. Yeah, so there's kind of two problems, that is kind of local problem, that's two different conjugacy class and packet, and the global problem, this global conjugacy class versus some kind of idyllic, that means every periodic numbers. And so automorphic represents this kind of complicated packet patterns that decompose. But Langlands somehow he immediately managed to get a precise conjecture about everything.
No, I would like to ask you, I mean, more still on this piece of work, but more on the human side. I mean, from your point of view, I mean, the fundamental lemma has been there, as we said, for many years. People in the field were actually starting writing important papers, assuming it, which is a faith that is shared by many famous statements in mathematics, like Poincaré conjecture or the Riemann hypothesis. So there must have been a lot of expectations around your work at that moment. And actually, your the work where you actually proved it's really a tour de force of almost 200 pages, I mean, of work, and history tells that it has been scrutinized for a long time in Princeton by many people, where you were actually doing that work. So also from the human side, it must have been kind of challenging. And I would like to ask you, was there a moment where you actually felt, yes, I'm sure I did it? I mean, they can scrutinize, they can check, but I'm sure.
This poem has an interesting story. So it started up as some kind of annoyance, right? Some kind of conundrum problem, but it ended up very important. But there were no single doubts about it. It just people are absolutely sure it's true. They don't know how to prove it. Right? Anyone, there's no single doubt. Right? It's just kind of amazing, and somehow it really. It's not vague, it's just completely precise, just this number had to be equal to that number. and people want to build up a lot of theory, assuming this thing is to be true, right? So for my personal story about this, and it just happened that when I did my PhD, my advisors, he's very careful about choosing students, and he polices no more than one student at a time. But it just so happened that we had two this year. So there's a problem that he kind of keep aside for the student he wanted to give to the other guy. And then when I arrived, somehow he was convinced that he wanted to take me. He doesn't have any problem. Kind of management from the student should give me that what he plan to work on. So that's something that is kind of fundamental lemma. It was very risky, right?
For a graduate student.
I know nothing about math, and I shouldn't know why he asked me to pull this number equal to that number. So I have absolutely no idea. I just started computing things.
This was in France, no?
It was in France. I mean, I would not give this kind of problem to a student. But and, you know, we had support to finish this in 4 years in France. That is kind
so
of
who was your advisor?
Lomont, Gérard Lomont. Mm-hmm. And after 3 years, I just have absolutely zero result. I just have nowhere to go. And when I come to see him, just, oh, Chau, you had to do something,
Graduate.
No, but it just somehow, I think a lot of luck. You know, by the end of 3 years, you know, we have a blue moon, we managed to have some kind of strategy how to prove this without computing. But to implement it, extremely difficult. And it just happened that in the fourth year, I got it completely. But it's some kind of both elementary, it's in a very lucky way. Even now when, you know, I understand and know more mathematics, I really want to turn that into some kind of more regular piece of mathematics. Couldn't. He just stayed in that in his
that
own
form.
Way. Yeah, so anyway, but you know the complex solution of that fundamental number of Jacquet and Ye was it's not so recognized, but it was actually extremely difficult piece of math, and but at that time I kind of get know how I could go to prove these kind of identities. I kept kind of general strategy in mind. But I But to do that, you know, that's kind of extremely difficult to try to find a geometry to, you know, to run this kind of ideas. So and when I was doing this, I just kind of create by hand some kind of funny geometries, and that works. But for the kind of true fundamental lemma, I was not able to, you know, I need more knowledge. And so there's a second funny story, and when I told this to Nigel Hitchin, he was laughing. Because that time, you know, we do not have, you know, we don't have to have one paper scanned by PDF. Mm-hmm. And that was excellent things. Because I was reading, you know, at that time, I think the geometric Langlands just start coming up, and everyone wanted to learn about what the hell it is. And I actually was reading, Roman was one of the initiators of this program with Valodia Dwinfen. And there was a paper of Roman on geometric Langlands published in this kind of Duke math volumes for the 50th birthday of Yuri Manin. So I was reading a lot more papers, which just happened the Hitchin paper to next to it. So I just made curiosity. I heard about this, but I know what it is about. I was reading it.
The Hitchin
papers about the integrable system. And so, the first reading I didn't really. It was not that hard. I mean, it's kind of easy to understand, but I didn't understand why make such a big fuss about this thing. It sounds kind of rather elementary, and then it's nice, but I don't know what to do. But then, it really, by the third reading, that I understood exactly what I was looking for for so many years. So that was the Hitchin paper. So that was the geometry that I need to apply, the kind of strategy that I had for my, for my PhD works. Yeah, so I think at some point, Lumong visited me in Vietnam, and I kind of discussed how the whole picture come together if you put a Hitchin vibration, and then immediately we work together for this kind of one single unitary case, and according to it's very fast, and it kind of, that was 2003 I think, and 2004 only got this Clay Prize for it, so it did extremely fast. The paper was written and it got immediately recognized by the communities and so on. So then I keep working on this, and I think I have really good start. I have good program, try to get a general case. But I think about 2007 I got seriously stuck. You know, I try whatever, you know, every single way to get around to realize, implement this program. I got the good geometry, good ideas, but the last step just cannot be proved. And that was seriously kind of depressed.
Discouraged.
So about 2007, I thought that it's okay. I mean, I think I got a good idea, but it won't be me, somebody else going to get it. So that was the time when I actually went to Princeton and
this is at the university or at the institute?
At the institute. The Langlands invited me.
The Langlands.
Yeah, Langlands invited me to come there for a couple of years to work on this, of course. But then I got this opportunity to speak in front of all these people in Langlands, the Lemma, Pearson, and so on. It's both a kind of big honors, but at the same time, I felt really bad because in my in the mind, I think I'm about to give up. I just try whatever I have. But there's nothing happens. Well, at some point, I after one of these lectures, I just hanging out with Mark Goreski. Mark Goreski was one of the creators of this theory of perverse shifts. So I just asked him kind of random question. Mark, this kind of situation, anybody have? Can say anything about this support of something, and he told this. I think I wrote up something, 20 years back, but never published it. Then let me go back and if you try my find notebook, if I found it, I will tell you. I didn't expect much, But next week he just came up with his notebook. He explained me something actually that is exactly a missing piece in my puzzle.
Amazing.
And after that, the whole thing just kind of put together beautifully. Yes, but of course, for that we have to wire up more difficulties. But
the main breakthrough was that.
The main breakthrough, but the critic when I about to give up, I got this last piece of the puzzle. Yes.
Yeah. So you brought it up already. one area in physics also where I know where people are quite sure that something which looks very different, A is equal to B, mm-hmm. even though they are really quite different at the face of it. And this is this very deep notion in physics called duality. Mm-hmm. And as I understand, geometric Langlands was is a kind of a geometric version of Langlands program. Uh-huh. And for example, you mentioned Drinfeld, but I think Witten and Kapustin had this paper explaining it in a language that physicists understand it, something to do with S-duality, which we know is some very important deep concept in physics. Uh-huh. So is it possible to phrase the fundamental lemma in that context so that it's closer to physics? And what is the relation, precise relation between geometric Langlands and the original Langlands program? I mean,
let me start with this first. Yeah. So the original Langlands program is starting from number theory, from class fin theory. It's really about number fins, right? Fin of Prussian numbers and finite extensions, and understand finite extension Galois group of the number fins. And Langlands come up with the idea that Galois, instead of understanding Galois group, it's trying to understand representation of Galois groups, and kind of extraordinary inside, he said that just this basically the same as automorphic representation, which has a kind of analytic object, like modular forms, some kind of analytic function satisfies some transformation on the symmetric spaces. All right, and then before Langlands coming up with his program, there was kind of revolution in algebraic geometry, right, starting with André Weil and then Grothendieck and so on, when he started working not with just algebraic varieties over complex numbers, like he'd been studying it in Italian in 19th century, such glorious. So you can study also algebraic varieties over finite fins, right? And then it was André Weil who was managed to have this beautiful proof for Riemann hypothesis for Riemann zeta function for curve, right? And he conjectured something for every algebraic varieties. And that was eventually proved by Grothendieck for many questions. And the last and most difficult thing was proven by Deligne. And that was kind of, a big part of history of development of algebraic geometries in 20th centuries. Right? And so it was on what, the whole part of Langlands problem can be formulated also for when you replace number of fins by fin of rational function of a curve over finite fins. Just completely parallel. Yeah, piece by piece, word by word, no difficulty at all, just translation of the country choice. It should work the same. But then it had been much more progress on that end. What is driving forward was Drinfeld, of course, who proved it for GN2, and he actually have many ideas, many different ways to prove it, by Stuka, by geometric Langlands. So Stuka was the object that he invented to kind of simulate Shimura varieties. And then the cohomology of it would give you the correspondence between Galois representation and automorphic forms. And geometric Langlands in different ways can be very different in the where he instead of construct some automorphic form, that eigenvalues of many operators, he construct a sheaf, erratic sheaf, right, that was invented by McPherson and Gruevski, McPherson and Deligne and so on. That satisfied the same, also eigenvectors and many operators. And so that was a whole program, geometric Langlands for curve over finite fins. And because the And they, you know, they soon realize that the same type of candidates work for curve over complex numbers, right? And replace shift by D modules, by system differential equations. And so then, and it was only, I think it was first by Berlinson and Drinfeld, they wrote this kind of magnificent opus of 300 pages where they kind of advertise the idea that geometric Langlands as the quantization of the Hitchin system. And only these papers, you know, these were papers wrote in by the beginning of the 90s. So the Hitchin vibration is often in great theories. That is very, you know, non-abelian Hodge theory and so on. Then. And Hitchin, when in these papers that I, you know, I just happened to read because of index to look more papers, he observed some very interesting phenomena that Hitchin vibration for duon groups are actually mirror symmetries to each other. It's just by observation. It's not, it didn't, you know, attach any kind of importance to it at that time. But you know, in Berlinson and Drinfeld, they think that, you know, the because when you have duon abelian scheme, there's a Fourier Mukai transform that can, you know, shift can be going back and forth, and if you and in the in the geometric Langlands program, if a question about quantizing that, you know, instead of all modules become, because the Hitchin vibration is a cotangent of the space of abundance. So instead of O module over cotangent, become D module over the modular space abundance. And that is because geometric Langlands. And I think then, you know, then kind of 10 years later, Witten have another reinterpretation of the same story with S dualities that I know, you understand, but I do not. Okay. So, but I think it's kind of very inspiring for development for the for this home from geometric Langlands. And to say that, you know, on the, when it, now it mostly developed on the side of complex numbers, and then, you know, most of the thing, it very become difficult to bring back to number theory, right? The, yeah, but this thing, there's an analogy, and it's more like an analogy than the theorem that can be used to. So, you know, the fundamental lemma is a piece in that, but it is.
So, what is the analogy of the fundamental lemma in geometric Langlands? Or what is the corresponding idea? Is it easy?
First of all, it is very, it's on Hitchin vibration, so it's before quantization, right? But there are various phenomena that now understood that is related to fundamental lemma. It can be stated purely in geometric terms. Nothing to do with packet representation. It's really a geometry of Hitchin vibration. For example, when the, you know, in Hitchin system, the geometric fibers can be its varieties. But when you get degenerated, it can have more components. If you can have two components instead of one. And that is the study of endoscopy can be understood in that way. And also, another phenomenon that you have to do onto that is it's not, it has two point of view. It can be moduli stack. You can also moduli space, right? So the difference is it is inertial group, you know, the kind of, when you describe Hitchin, you know, fixed field can get degenerated when the inertia just can pick up something more. And it just hope that the two are also dual. So this might have something to do with yes, dualities. On one side, the Hitchin fibers get more component, and then on the other side, some Hitchin bundles get more automorphisms. I think it's something like that has been written in Witten papers or so, but I don't know what is his physical interpretation. Yes.
Again, maybe passing from always to the, a little bit from the human side, I think out of this exciting conversation. There is also maybe a young mathematician could be slightly discouraged. I mean, if one wants to, which suggestion would you give to a young mathematician who wants to enter this field? I mean, there seems to be so much background needed from representation theory, algebraic geometry, integrable systems. Where is a good door to enter this this room?
Yeah, I mean, I keep telling my students not to be discouraged by on the background. When I start, I have absolutely no background. I mean, just pick up some question that find interesting and just try to solve it. But then, you know, it's just you have to enjoy whatever you can learn on the way, right? Instead of trying to learn everything before starting doing mathematics, I just try to learn by doing it. Right?
Mm. Yeah. Maybe I should ask you, Damien. You come from Vietnam. I had the pleasure of interviewing one of your good friends, I think, Dam Son. He's a Dirac medalist. He was here recently. So, and I think both of you are an inspiration to young aspiring scientists and mathematicians from Vietnam. So, and you probably worked in Vietnam at some critical time when the Berlin Wall fell, and I wanted to ask, and especially for ICTP, this is important because ICTP does believe that talent is uniformly distributed, and it is our responsibility to make opportunities available globally. Mm-hmm. And so can you say something about your experience, your path to mathematics in Vietnam, what you think one could do to enhance the interaction?
Well, I observed that my case or Sean case and a couple of colleagues about our age, there's one thing you can observe that when they were in the youth, you have very similar path, right? You have kind of very similar background, you come from the same cities, you live basically in the same neighborhood, and you have parents or professors. They're not very well, what to do, but we have such comfortable, I mean, and we are, you know, so many people to come to our family to talk about science, and we also do this kind of IMO trainings and so on. Mm-hmm. So that's just the difference between me and my friend was at they slightly older, which is 1 or 2 years, it's very not much, but the path that they go to, you know, the canonical path, they go to Moscow, go to MGU. Mm-hmm.
Went to Moscow, right? Yeah.
Sun and Fung Ho Hai, you know, Hai. Mm-hmm. I think he was there last month, and many other cases.
Yes. Fung, yes. We just said it as our guest, yes.
That's right, yes. So Fung is so the same generation, in the same path, they go to Moscow. But I just arrived in this 1 or 2 years later, and there's one thing that somehow for some reason I just decided I don't want to go to Moscow. I happened to go to Moscow before by the end of college, and I find it such a dark place. I just really have no intention to spend 5 years of my life into this building, just because
not the city, but the building, yes.
It's not the city, it's not the mathematics, it's just the building. Kind of. So I want to go, I think Hungary seems to be a happier place. So I actually decided I want to go to Hungary. Just out of, just...
Non-mathematical consideration.
Non-mathematical. Well, of course, I was kind of attracted by all these combinatorics that Hungarians do, but that's mostly because the building kind of scary to me. So. So I'm supposed to go to Hungary, but then again, the kind of coincidence of life, that was then the Berlin Wall collapse, and I lost my scholarship to go to Hungary.
Ah.
I couldn't go to Hungary. But then it just so happened at the same time, and one door closed, another door opens, and some French professor went to Vietnam in my father's institute, and his colleague introduced him to me, and he tried to get me a scholarship to go to France. It's very complicated, not going to waste your time with it, and eventually I went to France. Yeah, that was not my plan. But, yes. But I, you know, I kind of give your question. I But now I think that picture is completely different now. I mean, because you are taking care of kids in Vietnam doing IMO, they are completely different background. And we are a bit very uniform background, but now they
Diverse background.
Very diverse background. You can come from everywhere. They could, you know, they're not coming from university families. Just that was quite interesting.
That's also good. Yeah. Interesting.
But I think that, you know, I do agree with this ICTP motto that, you know, talents are uniformly distributed, but you need some kind of a favorable condition for them to grow.
Yes. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I just happen to be lucky that every single phase in my life, I just be in the ideal place to grow.
Yeah.
And so it's certainly probably. Some people are not that lucky.
Yes. I think it's also, yes. Sometimes it's the accidents of life, you know,
yeah,
that yes. work in your favor otherwise.
That's right, yes.
I mean, I guess nowadays science is really really global, and so maybe it's not a relevant question anymore, but do you think there is something, I mean, all said and done, still there are different schools of mathematics, like the Russian, the Moscow Landau school was different than, let's say, in Princeton. I mean, there is a different style of doing mathematics. Also, maybe, let's say, the Indian mathematicians like Ramanujan, their way of doing mathematics was different, okay? Not, is there something that you find that culturally, maybe it's not so, but is there some aspect of...
It used to be two, maybe even 20 years ago, right? This French school of mathematics, Russian school, American school, maybe even Harvard or Princeton, they're doing different kind of mathematics, but the Indian,
yeah.
So not just Ramanujan, but on the
Vector
bundles.
Yeah, Vector bundles.
The big thing in
Tata Institute.
In TIFR, right?
Right.
But nowadays, I think it, because of all these internet things, kids can learn really very fast.
Very fast.
I'm not sure that...
There is such a difference anymore.
Yeah.
Okay, maybe one last question we can, about the institute, maybe
yes.
You can ask, go ahead.
Okay, no, well, I mean, you are also among the many things, but you are also the scientific director of the Vietnamese Institute for Advanced Studies in Mathematics. In Hanoi, and you have been on this position for now quite a long time. I mean, so from actually the beginning of the institute. So, and ICTP had the pleasure to organize many schools in applied and pure mathematics. Actually, we are even increasing our collaboration in the next few years. So, I would like just to ask you, what are the goals of the institute at the moment, how is it, do you think it's affecting the development of mathematics in the region?
Yeah, so this is called another adventure, you know, when I, you know, one of the thing that changed a lot in my life is after the Finns Medon was, you know, I become more kind of public person. to be where I didn't really want to be that before, but it's interesting and I think it really enriched life. But, you know, as, you know, coming back to my background, because I received too much from the math community in Vietnam, with the way I grew up. People just keep encourage me, you know, give me advice on the way to, and I really feel a part of it, right? Then when I'm given opportunity to do something to help this community, I cannot say no. I'm not saying that I will, at the beginning I love it, but, you know, I couldn't just say no. But, you know, it happened to be a wonderful adventure, and for Vietnam, you know, there's one of the problem is the, although we have a talented young people, but they, of course, it's like everywhere, they just keep going away, right? They go to Europe, go to the USA, and the institute become kind of really a pawn at attracting them back. Although they are maybe not be going to spend in, you know, kind of permanent basis in Vietnam, but they really coming back. But for the time being, I don't even know who is there, because there's just so many people coming back and so many activities, just running seminar, conference, all the time, every single week. So they become just a kind of natural home. There's no need to try to attract, to call them anymore. It become their home, and that I'm really happy about that. And and also we already try to, that's the thing that I believe very much about the emergence of Asia, in the, not just in economics, but also in science, in academics, in these centuries. And yeah, I really want to be fully part of it. So I said, we are trying very much to be, to work together with on the countries in the region, like Singapore, Hong Kong, Korea, China, and India, to try to, piece by piece to have kind of communities and grow. Of course, the countries like we have ICTP, that is very critical, that we organize summer school where you can attract a student from even from Cambodia, from Laos, where the mathematics is not so much present, but who knows in the future, so getting better.
No, I think this is a very good point. I mean, I can say that after working, being in the US for many years, I really wanted to go back to India. And I could go back because Tata Institute, without really compromising my scientific goals, Tata Institute was a wonderful place with very high level of mathematics. And so it's clear that countries in Asia are now at a position, and you are trying to create something similar in Vietnam. And I'm sure it will succeed because there is so many talented young people there. And it's a question of slowly but surely it's going to grow on the world map. So the way I look at it is that, but I feel that ICTP still has a kind of a complementary role in this development of science, which should take place within the home countries to facilitate and to connect, let's say, Vietnamese mathematics a little bit more with, let's say, Indian mathematics or something. So,
I think ICTP have kind of really a very interesting role to play, because it's not good or not so good, because every country is kind of egoistic, right? It's really hard to try to convince our government to, we have to develop mathematics. But it's very hard to convince them. We also help our neighboring countries to develop mathematics. So I think then on that side, ICP can be very crucial and critical help to, so that all countries can grow together.
Yes.
And it just, that is, I think we are also feel so lucky that, in this, in mathematics, we, of course, there's competition. With the competition, you cannot really make serious progress. But also, it's kind of very secondary on this kind of universal endeavors that everybody is kind of contributes his break into building this magnificent edifice.
That's right. So I think, thank you. I think it's a good note. I mean, ICTP has recently been, we had some very nice agreements, let's say, with South Africa to collaborate. I mean, ICTP's role has changed, as you said correctly. All the communities around the world have grown themselves. So we have a very nice collaboration with South Africa. And I would look forward to a similar collaboration maybe at the national level with the Vietnamese community, and maybe we can talk about it later.
Sure.
Yes. So thank you very much, Chau. It was really wonderful.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, thank you, Claudio.